Howdy, it's Lachlan Thorne here on the Underground Alchemy channel, doing the first documentary star video on one of my favorite musicians, Elliott Smith.
Drink up, baby, stay up all night. When the things you could do, you won't, but you might. The potential you'll be, that you'll never see. The promises you'll only make. Drink up with me now and forget all about.
Stephen Paul Smith was born in 1969, Omaha, Nebraska. Later moving to Texas because his parents divorced at the age of one. But we don't have to worry about that. Growing up, he was seen as a bright kid, with music being played all the time in his family. You know, in a school talent show, he performed an original piece titled Fantasy on his piano. At the age of 14, he moved to Portland, Oregon. I don't know why Oregon. He went there before and he had a connection to it. I don't know, beavers? He had a connection to beavers. Sure, we'll go with that. At this time, he started recording demos on a tape recorder on his funky little piano. By the way, he was fucking awesome at piano. Check this shit out. You seeing what I'm seeing? I'm seeing legend. I'm seeing daddy. While studying in high school, he would perform in multiple bands while exploring his own sound and voice. During these bands, he met two fellas that are going to be very important later on in his story, named Neil Gus and Tony Lash. Also around this time, Stephen started calling himself Elliott. Yes, Elliott. As he showed disliking to the name, because he thought Stephen sounded too bookish and nerdy and geeky and weasery, and Steve sounded too much like a jock, straight guy, smack the booty. Little guy, you know? Honestly, I just think he didn't want to be confused with Steve from Minecraft. After legally changing his name to Elliott Smith, he moved back to Portland where the indie rock scene was thriving. This is where, after many failed experiments, he forms He Miser in 1991. Now, although Elliott grew up listening to the Beatles and Kiss and he enjoyed all that shit, this was some next level shit. This is hardcore. This is rock. It's grunge? Is it? Please don't kill me. Releasing three studio albums and one EP under Heat Miser, the band enjoyed decent success in Portland. However, all eyes seemed to be on the guitar player in the back. And what's his name? Ready? Elliott Smith. Especially when he releases this shit. Oh. Wait, this album? Oh. Yes, you heard it here, bitches. He released his first album named Roman Candle in 1994. Trying to get away from all the noise, he would seclude himself and record on his girlfriend's guitar and tape recorder at the time. And for all the snobs wondering what tape recorder it is,
it's a Tascam Porta Studio 4-track recorder.
It wasn't loud or anything, or any of that, anything related to Heat Miser. It was quiet, sophisticated, and had similarities to folk. In a music industry filled with yeah, this astounded everyone who listened to it at the time. However, although the good reviews, Elliott would tend to get triggered after many people said his music sounded like Simon and Garfunkel. I don't know what he had against Simon and Garfunkel. Anyway, I need to stop going on tangents, I swear to God. He would play numerous shows around Portland during this time, getting his name out there while living his blue-haired girl fantasies. Yeah. Some people were starting to catch on, but his next album is really what set people onto him. 1995, he releases his self-titled album with an album cover that's featuring two people jumping off a building to get ice cream. Well, that's what I thought. Come on. Regardless of the doom and gloom album cover, it actually had some decent hits. Many songs like Needle in the Hay and Clementine would become staples in Elliott's career, and one song even had a video. Featuring Elliott tripping over and eating a sandwich while he gives Doritos to children. Never have I seen a more handsome man in my entire life. And also, if you reverse the video, it looks like Elliott is stealing the soda from these children. That's right, bitch. Single and ready to mingle, him and his mate Larry Crane built a studio in Portland to record Elliott's new album, Either Or. That next year, Elliott Smith was set to release said album, but he almost canned it. Apparently, he had a slight hatred to most of the songs on the album due to its change of sound, but after being encouraged by friends to release it, his hatred softened, and good thing it fucking did, because this shit is bussin'. In fact, this is my favorite album of his. Every track from 1 to 12 is golden and unique in their own way, including Speed Trials, which is, in my opinion, the best album opener in, like, history. So, like, to promote the album, Elliott and a director recorded a short film titled Lucky 3, where Elliott plays three songs, including my favorite song of his, titled Angelus.
Someone's always coming around here, trailing some new cure. Says I seen your picture on a $100 bill. What's a game of chance to you? Him as one.
Elliott's shows at the time were also more popular than ever, filling our venues. People even said you could hear a fucking pin drop while Elliott played. That's how much people paid attention to it. Despite writing off his local success in Portland, Elliott had unfortunately been suffering from some demons. He was known to drink heavily during this era, and his friends were really worried about him. Due to this pressure and Elliott's growing exhaustion from Portland, he made the decision to move to New York in the summer of 1997. While Elliott moved to New York, something amazing happened. People from around the country were showing interest in his music, and this was happening at such a lucky time, in fact, that he was contacted by director Gus Van Sant to feature some songs in his upcoming movie, Good Will Hunting. This also included a quote-unquote original song written for the movie. More about that later, but this song was called Miss Misery, and it's pretty good. Yeah. Turns out that song wasn't written for the movie. It was a demo Elliott made, but he just rewrote some lyrics for it. He said this just in case he ever got an Oscar nomination for it, which he didn't think was going to happen, but like... So then later on in 1997, the movie comes out, and it does okay. Yeah, it does well. Then suddenly the fucking guy has an Oscar nomination. And he does his little ditty on live TV next to Celine Dion and Madonna on the Oscars. And then suddenly this dude's on the red carpet and he does a shit-ass interview with Carson on MTV.
MTV Live, my next guest is actually up for an Oscar for his work for Miss Misery, the song on the Good Will Hunting soundtrack. That is Elliott Smith. You feeling all right? Thank you for being here.
Yeah, I'm feeling pretty good. Thanks.
What is this tattoo, actually? It's the first thing I want to ask
you. It's a children's story. It's called Ferdinand. It's like a bull who doesn't want to go to the bullfight, but he does.
That's awesome.
What the fuck? Elliott said of all this that he would not want to live in that world, but it was fun to walk on the moon for a day. And indeed, he did walk on the moon for that day. And debatably, for the next 2 years. Despite being awkward as fuck during this era, Elliott found good use out of it, being signed to the same company that made Shrek 3 years later. Having access to a higher budget and more instruments to fuck around with, Elliott was ready to enter his goofy Beatles era. Later came his album XO. No, not The Weeknd! All jokes aside though, Elliott really went hard on this one, playing all the instruments on the album and writing it in New York bars. Here's a 90s as fuck commercial for XO. So Some hits on the album included Waltz No. 2 and Baby Britain, some of Elliott's most successful singles at that time, but my personal favorite from the album is I Didn't Understand, where all the instruments are stripped away and it's just Elliott. It is a perfect way to end an album. Although Elliott was a solo act, he thought he'd gather up a crew to tour with him. So in came his touring band from 1998 to 1999. According to sources, they all had a blast and even came to Australia, where I'm located. I could have seen him if my parents had sex like in the early 90s. This is not a phase, Mom. And he was about to prove that he wasn't just a one album cheap hoe. With his next album, because he scored twice on the charts. Yes, bitch. In 2000, Elliott Smith released Figure 8. On this record, Elliott embraces the piano in a way he never has before on tracks like Son of Sam or Everything Means Nothing to Me, songs that truly show Elliott's multi-instrumental talent. This album was also inspired by his move to LA, and he was hanging around fellas like John Bryan, a composer and musician in his own right, that often collaborate, including this airing of the John Bryan Show in 2000, where Elliott is doing covers sort of in a MTV Unplugged-esque aesthetic. It was wonderful times. He also went on tour this time, traveling all around the world, from America to Asia to Europe. He even grew his luscious long hair out, so now he's Indie Jesus. Some of my favorite shows in this era were The Howling Wolf, The Bumbershoot Festival, and The Fuji Rock, because of the sexy live band and just sounding like an awesome rock show. Elliott really put so much power in his voice on this tour, and it just shows that he really cared about these songs. There were so many avenues Elliott could go down here. He could score a soundtrack, collaborate with artists, write another album. However, his music career would be on pause due to some very devastating factors, including drug use. Yeah, he ended up leaving his record label DreamWorks in a nervous breakdown and was slowly but surely recording songs for his new album, trying to work around his addiction. Shows around this time appeared to feel unlike the Elliott of past times, but I clarified that this doesn't define him as a person. He was a human being that went through tough times, and if you want further information on this, I suggest you research it for yourself, because this is not what this video is about. In late 2002, he slowly started recovering from his drug use. Thank fucking fuck, man. I want to hear some new music. He began playing more shows in the LA area, where his vocals seemed sharper and his overall performance was getting better. He was talking to the audience, laughing along, and putting on a good show, which is just awesome to see after everything that had happened in the past couple of years. Back at home, Elliott began full work on his new album, which was now titled From a Basement on the Hill. On top of getting sober, so everyone give him a fucking applause, because this is a big dub for my man Elliott. Like, look at him riding on a pony, look at him, fucking dub. He played a show on Red Fest in September of 2003, and seemed to be going smoothly. It was great time. Elliott was recording more songs, getting clean, getting healthier than ever, also cutting caffeine, cutting junk food and all that shit. Unfortunately, the good news didn't really last long. Sometimes things aren't right under the microscope and we can't see it, and this really showed on the day of October 21st, 2003. On this day, Elliott Smith passed away due to 2 stab wounds to the chest. The circumstances to his death are heavily debated online, but there's one thing for certain. On that day, we lost a musical legend that inspired a new wave of indie musicians like Phoebe Bridgers and Frank Ocean, artists you see thriving in today's industry. With his simple on the surface but complex guitar playing, relatable imagery in his lyrics, and sexy ass hair, we can finally answer the question. Throughout his life, Elliott was a legendary musician in his generation and will always be a massive influence to artists for decades to come, as well as being a great friend and just an overall funny guy who I'd love to have a parasocial relationship with, but too bad he's dead. So who's Elliott Smith? Elliott Smith's a fucking legend.
I'm here today, expected to stay on and on and on. I can't do this song. I've played it too many times. I've just played it hundreds of times and I'm just sick of it.